It is now my honor to bring the big word for tonight. Yes, you. It's my humble honor and excitement to introduce our speaker, Mr. Donzel Leggett. Leggett. I don't know who Leggett is, but we'll find him soon. And as you read in the bio, he's a 15-year Chaska resident. Oh, Lord. And a 2018 candidate for the Minnesota House. Leggett is a vice president, global manufacturing excellence at the vice president of global manufacturing excellence. Ooh, I like that. At General Mills, Inc. I like it even better because I get my, I told you before, I get my pension check from them. So keep on working it. But he's also a commissioner on the Chaska of Human Rights Commission and a member of the board of directors for both Launch Ministries and Twin Cities Rise. And he is also a member here.
Not yet.
Okay, so we're working on it. We're working on it. He's a regular attendee within the community of Shepherd of the Hill Presbyterian Church. And so now is my great pleasure to bring you up here and to bring it, brother.
All right. All right. Let me open this up here a little bit. Well, good evening, everyone. Let me make sure that I can adjust this. Can everyone hear me okay? All right, so Denise said that it's up to me to bring the big word. I'll bring the big size. I'm not sure about the word. I'm 6'5", so I'll fast satisfy the big part of it. It's really a pleasure to be here. Shepherd of the Hill is the church that I attend, and I love it here. Great people, great pastor. And then when he's not here, we have a fantastic visiting pastor that's here as well. So we really enjoy it here. My wife Tracy's here, my daughter Gianna's here, her boyfriend Parker's here. Thanks for coming, Parker. Good to see you. As Denise talked about, one of the things that I do want to mention about my bio is just running for the State House. That was really an experience. And I do want to take a moment because there's a number of people who worked on my campaign that are here tonight and a number of you that that voted for me as well. And I just want to point out to you that, just because we didn't get the 116 votes that we needed to officially win the campaign, we did something that was pretty miraculous, here in this district and in the city of Chaska. We had the third largest reversal of Republican votes to Democratic votes in the state. We did that here. We gained 6,000 votes. We did that here. We got a lot of people out to the polls. We won Chaska by 500 votes. But most importantly, we brought a tremendous amount of energy and positivity to the people across this district, and particularly here in Chaska, people that hadn't been visited in 20 years, some people told us, never, some people told us, in particular neighborhoods that are not represented. So I just wanted to make that point. Now, it took a lot of energy. And so the holidays was something I was really looking forward to get some rest and some relaxation and kind of recharge the batteries. And the holidays typically are time you get the family here, so all my kids came, which was fantastic. We had a time to just kind of relax and be together. But also we talk about it's a time that miracles can happen. And you hear that and it's hard to believe that they can. But let me tell you, we had a couple miracles really happen in our family over the holiday season. On December 28th, I think it was, we were kind of sitting at home. I'm watching college football. Tracy comes out and says, hey, I just checked Ancestry because she hadn't checked it in a long time because she was working the campaign. And she says, there's someone on there that says that you could be their first cousin. And they're looking to want to talk to you. And I'm like, I know it's DNA, but I don't know, man. I'm watching this game right now. Can't wait, can't wait. So she, frustrated, leaves, goes back in there, checks on the computer, goes to find this guy's Facebook, gets a picture, calls me in, and says, you got to look at this guy's picture. You got to look at this guy. So I come and look at the picture. I'm like, whoa, okay, I see the resemblance. And I'm starting to, try to figure stuff out. And so I said, well, why don't you ask him some questions about, you know, where was he born, where was he conceived, all these types of things. And pretty quickly, I started narrowing it down that it's probably one of my uncles that passed away that was in the Air Force that might be his father. And at that point, Tracy said, you got to call him right now. And I'm like, can't it wait till tomorrow? She's like, this guy's probably sitting there with, you know, with just so much anticipation, thinking he might find his family, and you're saying you're going to wait because a game is on? Well, obviously, I didn't wait. I picked up the phone and called him. And we started talking, and I started explaining, you know, what I thought. And we figured out, you know, in very quick order, who he was. And he talked to his mother, and sure enough, validated that he was my uncle's son. And he was never knew. He's 48 years old. And 1 week later, he's in Key West, Florida, with all of my family, and they're taking him all around, showing him all the history about himself and his family. So a miracle for him feeling a void, and a miracle for us feeling a void. But that's not it. You see, God has plans. And as long as we step up and do stuff, he's going to make things happen. So just 3 days ago, Tracy comes and gets me again. And she says, you're not going to believe this, but there's somebody else that says that they're your either a first or second cousin. And of course, this time I get up immediately. I'm like, all right, we got to check this out. I said, I can't believe it. This can't be happening, but let's check it out. So we look at this young lady's picture, and immediately, again, I see the resemblance, and I see where she's from, and my gears start turning in my head, and I'm thinking that, you know, I know who she is, but I don't want to say anything, and I don't want to talk to my family, because I have a cousin that passed away suddenly about 20 years ago, 19 years ago, exactly, when he was about 19 years old. And we didn't think he had any children, but I'm thinking it has to be him. And the thing that was really a miracle is he passed away in November, I think, or October of 1999, and this young lady was born in January of 2000. And no one knew. She didn't know. Her mother didn't know. They weren't sure what the situation was. So I called, and when I talked to them and validated what I thought was true, the emotions just poured out of me. Because I knew what this would mean to my family, in particular my aunt, who lost her son and now has this granddaughter that literally is within 10 minutes of her house, and she didn't know. And it's all because Tracy started, made sure, first of all, she made me take the test to go on Ancestry and to get my DNA in. I'm the only one in my family that's done that. She pulled me off that couch 3 weeks ago and made me take action and contact, you know, who's now my cousin. And she got me to realize that it's all about us taking action. It's all about us not being silent. It's all about us doing what God gave us the ability to do, and that's to make miracles happen. To make miracles happen. And I just wanted to start with that story because when I think about what Dr. King, you know, means to me, the legacy to me, it's that legacy is about helping us understand that we can make miracles. We can make miracles by recognizing what's right. By making sure we recognize what's right, and then that we're never silent about what's right, and that we have the courage to act, to actually do something. And so I want to start off by talking about what do I mean by, you know, kind of recognizing what's right. You know, we're here at Shepherd Hill in this, you know, church, and I think it's important for me to tell you that I believe that God gives us the judgment to understand what's right and what's wrong. And it's up to us to make that judgment, but he allows us to see clearly if we want to. The problem is that many of us allow ourselves to be subjugated, to be distracted, whether it's our jobs, our careers, things that take our time, our network of friends and associates. Sometimes we can see the truth, but it may not be the truth that our friends would like. We're afraid that we might lose some friends if we recognize what's really the right thing. So we don't act on it. Social media distracts us. I'm looking at some of our young people in here. You know, we're on phones all the time. We're trying to figure out what's going on with all the celebrities. You know, we're on Instagram, or that's probably too old. Facebook for sure is too old. Maybe Snapchat, one of those kind of things. So that's taking a lot of time. People want to binge on television programs. You guys heard of this binging? You know, you can watch a whole season in a night, you stay up late at night, that distracts people. So you got all these things going on, and what it does, it distracts us from seeing what really matters. From seeing what really matters, from seeing the bigger picture. You ever heard the saying, and sometimes people get blinded by, they can't see the forest because the trees are right in front of them. That's all they see. And I think that's what all of this noise does to us. In fact, I talk about that, I think we let the ugly noise of nonsense drown out the beautiful sound of the truth. You know, I think we let, you know, things like, I call them eye candy. You know, they're distractions, things to make you look over here when the truth is standing right in front of you. My mother used to tell me, you know, when I would be looking for things I couldn't find, you're distracted, you're letting everything else get in the way, but that thing is right there, and if it was a snake, you would have bitten. You ever heard that? My mother would tell me that all the time. There's this, it's online, if you go and look for it, it's this video. It says, can you see the gorilla? Or the man in the gorilla suit. Has anyone seen it? You should Google it. The man in the gorilla suit, it's what it is. It's a group of people, they're all dressed in black, and they're passing around this ball. And they ask you, can you follow the ball and tell us who ends up with the ball? So it goes on, these people are passing the ball, and at the end, you know, I'm like, oh, it's that person right there, they have the ball. And they're like, okay, you're right. But did you ever see the man in the gorilla suit? And like nobody sees, and they go back and play the video, and they slow motion. And literally there's a guy who walks into the scene with a gorilla suit on, turns to the camera, waves, and then walks off. Nobody sees it because they're distracted. We have to filter out all that noise. We have to see what's really happening. We have to recognize what's really just. So once you recognize it, then we have to stamp out silence. You know, and we'll stop talking right now. Silence is loud. People think that if they just stay silent, no one hears. We do hear. Injustices continue when those of us who don't want to speak are silent. You know, nationally, we again, I'm just going to give you a couple things that are obvious. You know, yeah, we know that, as a simple example, we need border security. But is it right to separate children from their parents? Common sense would tell us that's not right. Is it right to lose a whole set of children, a whole group of children, no one knows where they are? That's not right. Is it right to have kids in cages with what looks like aluminum foil for blankets? Maybe it keeps them warm, but it certainly doesn't look humane. That's above any policy. That's just right or wrong. Is it right that we have people shut down the government and yet they still get paid, the ones who shut it down? And we have billionaires that still reap profits, while the folks who are scraping paycheck to paycheck that are supposed to keep our airports safe, they can't pay their rent. They're struggling. I mean, again, this isn't about policy, it's about just what's right or wrong. And right here in Chaska, you know, we have income inequity. I can tell you, because I've seen it. It's one of the things that I really had to wake up on when I went door to door. We have homelessness here. And believe it or not, we have racism here. You know, and this is something that, again, I was woken up to. It was confronted with it directly. You know, going door to door, I could see the significant disparity in living conditions. We have in this community homes that are $10 million. And we have homes where people are barely scraping by in trailers and can't afford repairs. Like I mentioned, we have homeless folks right here. They're sleeping in cars and couch hopping. We have people, and I met them, that literally have to choose. Literally have to choose between, can they pay their rent, can they buy food and put food on the table, or can they pay for the medical care that they or the person that depends on them need. Very, very heartbreaking, and I met these folks. And I can tell you, I've sat down with recent immigrants and people of color right here in this community, and we spent one night, it was about 2 hours, with them telling me all of the prejudice that they're exposed to. Right here in this community, insults, doing things as simple as, if you think it's simple, I gotta run to the store and get some milk. Most of us would think that's pretty simple. Go to the store, get your milk, come back. Well, sometimes if you're a Somali person and you're going to the Cub to get milk, you might not, to some person at the checkout might not want to check you out. Or someone in line might not want you in their line.
Some customer might give you a problem, give you a nasty look. Or you may have a child in school that's being taunted. Just in this city, and look, this is just facts. You know, in the last 3 months of last year, we had three incidents that made Twin Cities news. And they weren't good. They weren't good. At a Chaska High School game, we had kids wear blackface. The next month, we have Scaretown. Supervisor there tells them not to let Somalis in. In the third month, we had a child at one of our middle schools have a racial epitaph written on his shirt. That all happened in our community. It made Twin Cities news. Not the kind of thing that we want Chaska to be known for. And not the things, I'll be honest with you, that I've experienced here. But they're happening. They're occurring. And we can clearly see it's not right if we strip away the noise and all the distractions. You know, one of the things that I talk about is, you know, the worst thing that we can do in the face of physical, psychological, and emotional violence is perpetuate silence. And Dr. King said, there comes a time when silence is betrayal. When our lives begin to end the day when we become silent about the things that matter. And in the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, believe it or not, whether they're the president or not, it's the silence of our friends. How do we think the folks who are immigrants here are feeling when they're insulted and they don't feel like anyone's standing up, no one's saying anything? How do the folks who are struggling in living conditions that they can't find anywhere to live and they're silenced? And we're friends. And then there's action. As I said earlier, Dr. King's legacy kind of begins with making us confront what is right and just, and then demanding that we end silence. But ultimately, he was known for acting. And I think we heard that from Denise and from Dean. You know, I spoke at this church back in August about the A attitudes of leadership. Those are accessibility, authenticity, adoration, accountability, and action. And Dr. King exemplifies the A attitudes, you know, really, really perfectly. You know, he was accessible. He went wherever he had to go, no matter the danger. He went in the midst of people. He went in the teeth of danger. He was authentic. He stood up for his belief, in particular for nonviolent resistance. And that was even when people in his own circle started telling him, I think time's passing you by, you need to change. Other African Americans said, you know, he's passe, we don't want to follow that, we think it's time to stand up and fight. And even the government turned against him when he decided to take a stand against the Vietnam War. He still stayed true to his beliefs. He showed adoration, you know, he truly loved people. He famously said, you know, I've decided to stick with love because hate is too great a burden to bear. And he was accountable. You know, we all know there were attempts on his life, and ultimately there was one that was successful. There were innumerable threats, but he never wavered. And he said during that speech that Dean Seal referenced, you know, I've been to the mountaintop speech, for when people get caught up with that which is right, and they're willing to sacrifice for it, there's no stopping a point short from victory. But as I said, it was action that really separates him and really cemented his legacy. If you think about the times that we're in right now, you think they're difficult, you think dealing with the current president, the current administration is difficult, there's problems. Imagine being a black man in Alabama in 1950. Imagine that. But in that time, he was thrust into a decision of deciding. People think he was thrust into action, no, he was thrust into making a choice. Act or don't act. He decided to act. You know, many of you remember, you know, what happened. Rosa Parks was asked to give up her seat, and she said no. That sparked an outrage. People decided to not lay down and to boycott the buses. They needed a spokesperson. Dr. King, 26 years old, 1 year older than my son today. There's no way I could see my son do it. No way. 26 years old. He decided to put himself there and to act. But he didn't stop there. He became the international face of civil rights. and racial injustice, fighting for racial justice. But he also became the face of the person fighting for the poor. Some people forget, but he started the Poor People's Campaign. He also fought for humanity. I mentioned he called for an end to the Vietnam War. He lost a lot of popularity in this country for doing that. He fought for the fair treatment of workers. In fact, you know, he was assassinated in Memphis because he was called there to speak on behalf of the striking sanitation workers. That's why he was in Memphis. He wanted to fight to make things fair for everyone. He was a person that was just like me and you, though. I mean, the people want to, you know, put him as an idol, but he was a guy. He was a guy that wanted to see his kids grow old. He wanted to be with his wife and enjoy and retire. You know, he wanted to be able to do some fun things, you know, maybe, who knows, maybe even buy a cabin up north. Maybe he'd like to do something. But he was a guy that was wanted to do those things. But as Dean said, he chose to act. He chose to stand up and not remain silent. He knew that to truly change this country, though, and to save our collective conscience, that it had to be bigger than him. Couldn't just be him. Even if he gave his life, couldn't be him. You know, you see that it's not enough to just inspire people to believe in a vision of a great movement. You must compel them to engage and commit to join the movement, or the movement will die. Dr. King said, a genuine leader is not a searcher of consensus. It's a molder of consensus. Mm-hmm. He appealed to the humanity of the masses at the time. Decent people, mostly white people, across the country to be confronted with the ugliness of Jim Crow racism. That's why he wanted nonviolence to be televised, so that people could not walk away from seeing people who were not being violent be brutalized. He brought all clergy together from all faiths. Dean mentioned this. And he made them be confronted with what was right. He appealed to their conscience, because at the time, many of them were not speaking out. And he was able to mold a consensus with them to say, we will no longer be silent, and we will stand united for righteousness. For righteousness. Whether we're Episcopalian, Presbyterian, Catholic, whether we're Jewish, we understand that this is about right and wrong. You know, many of us in our community, you know, even here tonight, we have different views on different things, especially policy type things. And that's normal. We're not going to agree on everything. But it's unfortunate, you know, when we allow ourselves to be forced into categories of policy and rhetoric versus pushing ourselves to see the bigger picture and use our own judgment about what's right and what's wrong. We must elevate above the noise and distractions to see clearly and choose the side of right and inspire the passion in others to speak out and to act. Some are going to try to make it difficult on you if you do this. Some are going to try to pitch you against others. Some are going to put pressure on you. Some are going to say, hey, you're selling out. They're going to do whatever they can to keep you in that box. But as Dr. King said, the ultimate measure of a man or a woman is not where they stand in moments of comfort and convenience, but where they stand at times of challenge and controversy. And see, many of us, we want, when there's challenges and controversy, we want a savior to come. Maybe there'll be another king. Maybe Jesus is coming back. We can wait for that. You know, God bless me, and Jesus showed up right now and said, Donzel, what have you been doing while I've been gone? I think I want to say I've been working on your behalf. Now I've been waiting for you. I think you'd be more apt that I'm here working than waiting. And I think we all have to recognize that if we're waiting for saviors, we're waiting for leaders, it ain't gonna happen. The leaders we're waiting on are us. And the fight is for what is right. And the time is now. You know, we may not have all the same talents or be able to do all the same things, but all of us can do something. You know, Dr. King said, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But do something. Do something and keep moving forward. If you don't know what that means, I'll translate it for you. It means if you can't come up here and give a speech, be a speechwriter. We can do that. If you can't go to the Capitol, you can start a petition and have someone take it to the Capitol for you. You can write a letter. You can call. If you can't host a homeless family in your home, you can make food and you can bring it. If you can't donate money, you can't afford it, you can volunteer your time and your talents. And if you see racism, and if you see people being mistreated, you can speak up. You can say something. You can eliminate the silence. If you don't know others, get to know them so they're not others anymore. Learn about Somali culture. Learn about Central American culture. Many people think we have a lot of Mexicans that live in this town. No, we have a lot of people who are from Central and South America in this town. Learn about their cultures. Did you know they have a soccer league made up of almost 20 different nations represented in that league, all that live here in Chaska, believe it or not. You can go to a city council meeting and hold your city leaders accountable. You go to a school board meeting and you can demand that they continue to move this city forward to be a city of inclusion. So the challenge I give you is if you want things to change, if you want to create your own miracles, if you want miracles to happen, then remember that it's always the right time to do what's right. It is always the right time to do what's right. So thank you for having me. This has been wonderful, just getting a chance to talk to everyone. And I really hope that I touched something in your hearts, because I was speaking from the heart tonight. So good night.